So this part of the country, I think, has been very instrumental in getting Bernie to run, in providing that initial support. And of course, this part of the country has maintained the progressive spirit that is so important for the entire country. And this part of the country was right when you all said, don't go invade Iraq. It's a really, really bad idea. And boy, I wish the powers that be had listened to what you all were saying here. We wouldn't be in the situation we're in right now. And when I go into Congress with my colleague Tige, and let me give a shout out to Tige over there, who is so active in Code Pink and shows that men look really good in pink. When we go into Congress and we hear them say, the problem with Iraq right now is that Barack Obama took those troops out too early. And exactly, the groans is what we do. We go, You know, let's be clear about what history has showed us here, which is that those of us who said, do not go invade Iraq, it had nothing to do with 9/11, it's going to be a disaster, we were totally right, they were totally wrong, and the reason that we have something like ISIL today is not because Obama took the troops out of Iraq too soon, it's because George Bush invaded Iraq. And let's be clear and not let them rewrite the history. So for those of you who don't know Code Pink, we started out right after 9/11 trying to stop the invasion of Iraq. We were a group of women environmentalists who realized that a war would be so disastrous for the environment, and we thought, all right, we're going to create this group based on George Bush's color-coded alert system, the yellow, the orange, the red, and which was this absolutely absurd system, because what did it mean when the alert level went from yellow to orange? People kept saying, what are we supposed to do? What are we supposed to do? And the government had no idea what to tell us, except finally they said something like, well, get some duct tape and some plastic sheeting. And we never knew what we're supposed to do with the duct tape and plastic sheeting, but it was designed to keep us in this constant state of fear. And so when we were a group of women sitting around, we said, there has to be another way to react to 9/11. Let's call a code hot pink alert, except when we got home and looked online, it was already a porn site, so we couldn't be hot pink. It was a great disappointment to be only pink, especially for those of us who didn't think of ourselves as the kind of people that would dress in pink. But we also didn't plan on creating an organization. We thought we would just join the growing movement of people around the country who were saying no to war. We would stop the war, and then we'd go back to doing the other things that we were doing. Unfortunately, things haven't worked out that way. And it's been now 13 years of constant organizing, like many of you have been doing, to try to turn around our government's policies. And when we created Code Pink, it was before the US invasion of Iraq, and one of the first things we said is, it's going to be very hard for us to talk about Iraq without having been there. And so we immediately organized a group of crazy women and went to Iraq just at the time when the US was supposed to be invading, not knowing what we'd find, how we'd be treating, having these very stereotypical ideas in our own heads about what Iraq would be like under the dictatorship of Saddam Hussein, thinking we'd see, you know, repressed women who would have a difficult time reaching out to us. And the first women that we had been put in touch with, the woman that I first met in Iraq came up to me and said, I have a very important question for you. And I said, okay, you know, what is it? She said, which of the black American women poets is your favorite poet? And at that point, I was drawing a total blank, and she's going, well, come on, you know, is it Nikki Giovanni? Is it Alice Walker? I said, how do you know these people? Have you lived in the United States? She said, no, I've never been outside of Iraq in my life. But I studied American literature at the University of Baghdad. And that was my first a chance to kind of blow away the stereotypes. And after that, we met all kinds of wonderful women who were judges and architects and engineers and lawyers. And we realized that this was, even after 13 years of sanctions, a very well-educated country where, unlike in our own country, education was free throughout college. You could become a PhD or a doctor and never pay a penny. We also learned that healthcare, which had been very much hurt under those 13 years of sanctions, was considered a right to Iraqi citizens, and that people had been coming from all over the Middle East to both get healthcare as well as to get access to good education. And you look at Iraq today, and people in the region say, we think the United States just doesn't want strong countries in the Middle East that can challenge U.S. authority. And certainly it's hard to argue with the results of that, because the result has been to destroy Iraq, take this country that where Shia and Sunni and Kurds actually live together in mixed neighborhoods. We had a friend that we worked with that ran a women's group in Iraq, and she didn't like Saddam Hussein at all. And we said, what can we do to support you? And she said, please, 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 just don't let your government come in to liberate us. That's all we're asking for. And she had a Sunni father and a Shia mother. And she said, never was an issue. Never even came up as they were growing up. And once we were giving a talk together in a U.S. audience, and somebody said, what has been the main outcome of the U.S. invasion? And she said, it's very simple. The U.S. taught us how to hate each other. And that really is the results of the U.S. invasion. Teaching Sunnis that they should hate Shias, teaching them that they should hate the Kurds, and creating this sectarian violence that opened the way for ISIL to come in now and take over large swaths of both Iraq and Syria. So when we say that there are no military solutions to the problems in the Middle East, and we look at Syria and we see the tremendous bloodletting that's going on there, and as we go into Congress, we find the Republicans saying, the Obama administration isn't doing enough in Syria, we gotta send more troops in there, there should be American troops on the ground, there should be more troops in Iraq. We say, will they never learn? Will they never learn that U.S. military involvement is part of the problem and is not the solution? And when we look at the growing involvement in Syria today of the United States, we see that U.S. just got access to a base in Turkey that is now being used for U.S. both piloted and drone planes to fly from. And lo and behold, the U.S. government discovers that its ally Turkey is not really interested in fighting ISIL. It's much more interested in fighting the Kurds, who have for decades been trying to get their own autonomous region, and it's more interested in fighting Assad. So it is extremely complicated region, and U.S. involvement is only making matters worse. And when you look around at what has happened over the years, well, the government of the United States has not decided, okay, U.S. militarism doesn't work. What they have seen is that the American people were becoming weary of the wars. I actually call it war wise, because I think the American people have understood that these wars have only spread extremism around the world and have taken trillions of dollars that we need for other things, have left thousands and tens of thousands of U.S. soldiers dead or injured, and have just wreaked havoc throughout the Middle East. But instead, what Obama did was return some of the troops back to the United States, but start the drone wars. And that's why I did a lot of research and wrote this book. And if you haven't had a chance to read it, I hope you'll get a copy of it today. It's called Drone Warfare, Killing by Remote Control. And really goes into detail of this transition from troops on the ground into using this really horrendous new technology that allows U.S. soldiers to be sitting comfortably in an air-conditioned room here in the United States and to be sitting in an ergonomic chair looking at a screen of people that are thousands of miles away and being told at some point to press a button that would unleash a Hellfire missile and just wipe these people out. And when we first started doing this work, the government was lying to us and saying, oh, well, we have this great technology and we have these smart bombs and we only kill militants. Militants. Well, little did we know at the point that militant meant anybody who was a military age male who was living in the places where we were using the drones. That was the definition of a militant. And little did we know at that time that every week there were meetings at the White House to come up with a kill list to decide who they're going to kill. So there were two ways. One was a kill list that say, okay, we know you, Carolyn, or we know you, Packy, we're going to go and kill you. And the other was just to look at the suspicious-looking people doing suspicious activity and just kill them. And yet, we had John Brennan back in 2011, 2012, telling us that there were no innocent civilians who had been killed. And so some of us went to Afghanistan, some of us went to Yemen, we met with families of innocent victims, and we came back and said, our government is lying to us. There are actually thousands of people who've been killed by these drones, and we don't know who they are. Only 2% of them were on a kill list where we could actually name who they were. The rest of them, we don't know who they are. And many of them innocent people, and many of them low-level militants who had no intention or desire of killing Americans. In fact, when we went to visit a family in Yemen, where the sister said that her three brothers had actually joined Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula in Yemen, she said to us that they were involved because they hated the dictatorship in Yemen at that point. They wanted to do something to overthrow the dictatorship, and the only people they could find who were fighting the dictator were Al-Qaeda. And so they joined Al-Qaeda. It had nothing to do with the United States. And the sister said to us, look, I'm smarter than my brothers. I Googled Al-Qaeda. I learned about them. I saw they were terrible and they did terrible things. But my brothers, all they wanted to do was fight the dictator, and so they joined Al-Qaeda. And they were like 17, 19, and 21-year-old young men. And if you put it in the U.S. context, it would be as if they joined the wrong gang. They joined a bad gang. And this young woman said to me, they needed re-education, and we had been talking to them, and they were going to surrender. But instead of re-education, they got killed by a U.S. Hellfire missile. And now all of their friends are looking at the United States and saying, that's the country that killed them. We now hate the United States. So creating enemies. That's certainly what we've been doing with this drone warfare. And in fact, there were only about 200 people who were part of Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula when Obama started using the drones in 2009, and then it skyrocketed to over 1,000 members once we started using the drone warfare. We met this young man in Yemen who came to visit us and brought two young children. And he said, these are my brother's children who will never see their father again in their lives. Their father was driving a taxi. He picked up some strangers, as you do when you drive a taxi. He was driving them all along a road, and all of a sudden there was a hell drop from the sky. My brother and the two other people in the taxi were incinerated. The taxi was a smoldering melt of metal. And he said he went to the U.S. Embassy to demand an explanation, to say, why did you kill my brother? My brother was not involved in any kind of militant activities. He couldn't even get to the U.S. Embassy. They wouldn't allow him near the embassy. And he said to us, in my tribal culture, if you do something terrible, whether it's a mistake or on purpose, you have to acknowledge what you did, you have to apologize, and you have to compensate. And he said, could it be that my tribe is more advanced when it comes to justice than the United States of America? Unfortunately, yes. And so we have been working with those people who are the victims of our drone strikes, brought some of them here to testify for the first time ever in Congress. I must say that Jim McGovern was a tremendous help to us in getting them and in organizing briefings in Congress for drone strike victims, one of the few Congress people who would help us. And we have managed to do some kind of changes in the last couple of years about the drone warfare program. It's not enough, but it shows that activism does help. What has happened is that we've embarrassed the government over their program. We forced them to talk about it. We forced them to change the policy to say they would be more careful about pressing that button. The number of drone strikes in Pakistan and Yemen and Somalia have gone down significantly. And we've also forced them to provide compensation for the families of innocent victims. We've also worked overseas with countries in Europe that wanted to get this technology for themselves. And now there is a network globally to try to stop the proliferation of drone warfare. So these are some positive accomplishments that have come out of the movement, but we must recognize that we can't stop until we ground the drones and end the use of drones as a kind of way of intervening overseas. And as part of this, it really is looking to how can we change our government's policy of using militarism to resolve conflicts. And when Obama was talking about his new accomplishment around Iran, which I'm going to talk about in detail, he bragged when he was talking about it, saying, but you know, I'm not weak. I have bombed 7 different countries during my administration. I am a tough guy. He has even said to the media, I don't mind killing. I don't mind putting people on a kill list. This kind of bravado seems to be what, quote, leaders of our country feel that they have to say, even as they move towards a different kind of foreign policy. And moving towards that different kind of foreign policy, I just want to recognize that when we talk about militarism overseas, we really have to make the connections between the militarism in our own communities, because it's the same kind of racist policies that allows us to press a button to kill poor people of color in other countries thousands of miles away that we don't even know who they are or we don't know what activities they're involved in, is the same kind of racism that has allowed the police to be killing on a regular basis poor people of color in our own communities. And it's the same kind of militaristic approach to issues overseas that has allowed the, quote, Defense Department, which should not be called defense, to be dumping military-grade hardware into our communities for, quote, free, supposedly surplus military hardware, which it turns out a lot of it isn't even surplus at all. A lot of it is new stuff that was bought by the Pentagon, not used, and so gifted to police departments around this country. And things that our community should never see in the streets, like the tanks that we see that came out in Ferguson when people first started rising up, or the assault weapons, or the grenade launchers and the silencers and all this kind of military equipment that communities are now asking the police departments to give back, saying we don't want these in our communities. And when we went to Ferguson as Code Pink to try to be in solidarity with the people who were out on the streets, we met with mothers whose loved ones, whose sons had been killed by the police. And we asked them, as a women-led led organization, what can we do to be supportive? And they said, bring us to Washington, D.C. and organize meetings for us with Congress, with the ill-named Department of Justice, with the White House. And we did that. We brought 12 women to Washington, D.C. We set up these very, very important meetings for them. We also introduced them to the young people in D.C. who were going out on the streets day after day. They joined us for those rallies, for those protests. And one night as we were sitting around in the Code Pink House in D.C., one of the women was looking on the walls, and the walls have posters talking about militarism, calling for an end to militarism. And one of the women said, you know, there is a direct connection between these wars overseas and what's happening in our community. The policeman who killed my son was a veteran who had recently returned from Iraq. And I asked them to raise their hands if others had a similar experience. And one by one, the hands were going up. My son was killed by a veteran who returned from Afghanistan. My son by a veteran who returned from Iraq. And we have to recognize that veterans are given priority employment in our police departments. And here you have people who come back from these overseas tours of duty with PTSD, trigger happy. We're giving them guns and we're sending them out into our streets. So we don't have to look very far to recognize the connections between this very strong movement for Black Lives Matter right now and the work that many of us have been doing to oppose militarism overseas. And because there has been some tension between some of the Black Lives Matter folks that have been getting up on stage to interrupt some of our friends like Bernie Sanders, I thought it was important maybe to spend a minute talking about that. How many of you honestly felt uncomfortable at all about the interruptions of Bernie Sanders? So I see a lot of hands in the room. And I am somebody who has done a lot of interrupting. Interrupting Barack Obama. We had a campaign when Hillary Clinton was running for office that was called Bird Dog Hillary. And we went every single place where she was and said, Hillary, listen to the people. Don't vote for the war in Iraq, which she did not listen to, voted for the war in Iraq. We got a lot of grief from women's organizations saying, how can you do that to Hillary Clinton? And we've gotten a lot of grief over the years for bird dogging some people who were our friends, in quotes. I put that in quotes. And I think it's important to recognize that there are life and death issues, like these wars overseas and like the wars at home. And that we have to get attention to these issues in any non-violent ways that we can. And when you get up on a stage, you're not doing that because you want to do that. You're doing that out of desperation. You're doing that because you feel the issues are so important that you are going to overcome your own fears by getting up there and calling out not just the person who you are interrupting, but it's really to a much broader audience and the media who come to these things to say, help, help. We are in an emergency situation and we need to talk about these issues. And look at what has happened in just a small period of time from the moment that a couple of people jumped on stage when Bernie Sanders was talking in Netroots Nation and then did it one other time in Seattle. Look at what has resulted from that. It is a conversation that has increased in intensity throughout the country. It is a conversation that has improved Bernie Sanders' message tremendously on these issues of race. It is a conversation that made Bernie Sanders sit down with Black Lives Matter people and immediately hire a young woman to be his communications person and to not only have her behind the scenes, but have her coming out before he gets on stage to talk about this issue. It's had Bernie Sanders incorporate this issue into the core of what he's speaking about, not just say racism is a result of economic equality, but recognize it as its own important substantive issue that has to be addressed. It's forced Hillary Clinton, and it's now forcing the Republicans to talk about this issue. So we've had a black president for a long time, and I would say these young people are doing more to force the issue about racism and white supremacy in this country than Obama has in his time in office. So there's another group of very courageous people that I wanted to call attention to because one of them needs a lot of support from us right now, and that is whistleblowers. And some of the whistleblowers that have been so key to us learning about what our government is doing overseas are either holed up in the Ecuadorian embassy, like Julian Assange from WikiLeaks, or like Edward Snowden, who is stuck in Moscow instead of being back home in the United States, or we have Chelsea Manning, who has put a call out to her lawyers saying, help, they are threatening to put me into solitary confinement for absolutely ridiculous things, like having publications in my cell that they don't like, or having an expired tube of toothpaste that they say violates the rules about expired medicines. And these ridiculous things are being used to threaten her. And so we put out a call with other groups like Roots Action to say, sign on to these petitions. About 60,000 people have signed on already. We need more. And so we're going to pass around a sign-up sheet now that we hope you will sign on to. We will add you to this petition for Chelsea Manning, and you will only get one email from us every week, but it will be critical things. And we're taking these petitions into the Pentagon on Tuesday. So the more people that we can get to sign on to support Chelsea Manning, the better. And then I want to talk about the other positive things that are happening right now, and that is that it seems that after many years in office, Barack Obama has suddenly discovered the meaning of the word diplomacy, that maybe he's trying to earn that Nobel Peace Prize that he won. For whatever the reasons, there are several very, very, very good things happening right now. And one of them is the thawing of diplomatic relations with Cuba. It's quite remarkable to see, after 5 decades and president after president coming in and not doing anything to change the ridiculous policy that the United States has had towards Cuba, that there have been talks initiated by the White House with the help of the Pope, with the help of the Canadian government, and of course with the help of the Cuban government, to be figuring out how can we move into a new path with Cuba. And lo and behold, on December 17th of last year, Obama and the Cubans get up and announce that they are working towards having renewed diplomatic ties, and those diplomatic ties in the U.S. now embassy in Havana just happened on Friday, with the U.S. flag going up and the U.S. intersection becoming an embassy. Extremely positive thing. How many of you here have visited Cuba? So a few of you have. Do you know that it is still illegal for you to go to Cuba as a tourist? Yes. So you can now squeeze into one of 12 categories that Obama has expanded for travel to Cuba. But you still can't go like a Canadian and say, boy, it's cold in this part of the country in winter. I want to go for a long weekend on a little junket over to Cuba and lie on the beach and get warm. That would be illegal, still today. So one of your congressmen, Jim McGovern, has been working very, very hard on this. In fact, he was in Havana for the raising of the flag and the opening of the embassy, and he has been working hard to try to lift that ridiculous travel ban. And then there is the trade embargo. There still is a trade embargo. In Washington, D.C., when the Cubans turned their intersection into an embassy, and they had a celebration inside, and a lot of the people who were invited by the Cubans were business people. They have been working very hard to lift the trade embargo, especially people involved in agriculture, because they want to sell, unfortunately, like GMO kind of crap to Cuba. But they feel that Cubans are buying rice from Vietnam. They should be buying rice from here in the United States. They're buying frozen chicken from New Zealand. They should be buying it from the United States. So there has been a lot of lobbying by U.S. companies. And in fact, there are quite a number of Republicans who are pushing to get this embargo lifted. But it still hasn't been lifted, and it's still something that we really need to do. It was kind of ironic hearing John Kerry, though, when he was in Cuba, feeling obligated to call out the Cuban government about its human rights abuses. And certainly there are things that the Cubans could and should be doing to open up more freedom of speech and freedom of assembly in Cuba. But it is ironic coming from a United States official when the U.S. continues to hold a piece of Cuban land called Guantanamo that should be in the hands of the Cubans and continues to hold people prisoner now for 14 years. Over half of the ones who are there have been cleared for release ages ago and still haven't been released, tortured on Cuban soil, kept in this limbo of total illegality according to international law. So there were a number of Cubans who did remind John Kerry of that fact while he was there. So the other main issue that I wanted to talk about today was Iran, because the issue about Iran is so incredible. I mean, on the one hand, there are Iranians of different political persuasions in Iran, and Tyg and I have both been to Iran a couple of times quite recently, Iranians saying, we don't think we should have had to even negotiate this deal. Why should we have been singled out? We say that we are not building nuclear weapons. We are only working towards nuclear power, which is our right. And there is only one country in the Middle East that has nuclear weapons, and that is not Iran, that is
Israel.
And they ask, why isn't the world calling on Israel to get rid of its nuclear weapons? Or at least join the non-proliferation treaty? At least allow inspectors in? Why isn't that any of that even mentioned in this entire time while these negotiations are going on? And they also say to us in Iran, why isn't the U.S. even abiding by its own obligations according to the non-proliferation treaty? It's supposed to be getting rid of its nuclear weapons, and instead it's going to invest $1 trillion to upgrade its nuclear weapons. Why isn't that part of the negotiations? But of course, it's the powerful, the U.S., that has the cards on the table, and those are about what are we going to do about Iran. So given that, it is quite miraculous that they came up with a deal. It's quite miraculous that the Iranians negotiated this deal. It's quite miraculous that John Kerry did not walk away from the table at different points and stayed and stayed and stayed. So really, it is a marvel that a deal was struck. And the world is loving it. It was passed unanimously at the UN Security Council. All over the world, people are praising the fact that they came up with this deal. There is only one country that has publicly come out against the deal among the entire world of nations, and that country is? No, it's Israel. It's Israel. It's the Israeli government. Our government, our White House, negotiated that deal. But then there is the issue of the U.S. Congress. Now, when the deal was struck, the poll showed the majority of Americans in favor of this. Who wouldn't be? Majority of Americans saying, we don't want a war. We've had enough of that. We want this deal to go through. But then came the powerful lobby groups to try to change the minds of Americans and try to influence Congress. There is one organization, the most powerful foreign policy lobby group in the United States, and that is
AIPAC.
Now, you're not clapping for AIPAC, are you? Could be. And there are very nice people who are in AIPAC. You know, I'm Jewish. I know a lot of Jews who are in AIPAC. They got into AIPAC because they grew up hearing about that we Jews had to make sure that there was never again a Holocaust, and the way to do that was to form the strong lobby and protect Israel. And unfortunately, AIPAC has become a right-wing lobby group protecting a right-wing government in Israel that is not only exploiting on an everyday basis the Palestinian people and doing things like invading Gaza 3 times in the last 5 years and killing thousands of people, including just the last time killing 551 children, but Israel is also trying to squash this Iran deal. And it is amazing to see that groups like AIPAC have invested millions of dollars, over $20 million, in a very short period of time. In fact, created a new organization, putting massive amounts of ads into the television, into the major newspapers all around the country, working with other groups, not just Jewish groups, non-Jewish groups, including groups like Christians United for Israel, that are also doing massive lobbying against this. And they're starting to turn U.S. public opinion around because their ads are so scary. Raise your hand if you've seen any of their ads. So they're scary ads, right? I mean, some of them are absolutely ridiculous. The ones on TV that, what?
They're all ridiculous.
They're all ridiculous. Showing these very Middle Eastern-looking people driving a van and driving it into a factory, and suddenly the factory blows up. And it's like, these Iranians are getting a bomb and they're gonna stick it in the back of a truck and they're gonna go into your town and blow up the nearest factory. I mean, ridiculous stuff, but fear-mongering works. And then there are the U.S. Congress people. Now, the U.S. Congress people are not motivated by fear of Iran, let's face it. They are motivated by
money.
They're money by money. Money, 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 money. Because we have this crazy system where they, in the Congress, where they run every 2 years and they have to raise millions of dollars every 2 years and they're always dialing for dollars. And so groups like AIPAC have become incredibly powerful. Why in the world would we be at the point right now where we have this great Iran deal on the table, and we know that a majority of people in Congress are going to vote against it? It doesn't make any sense from a rational point of view of how a democracy is supposed to work. And there are significant groups that are organized to try to get this deal passed. We don't have nearly the funds that the opposition has. But there are groups like MoveOn.org, there are groups like the telephone company Credo, coalition of groups called Win Without War, Peace Action, Code Pink, Veterans for Peace. There are groups like J Street that are working on this, making this a priority. There are a lot of organizations working for this deal. But we are outnumbered in terms of the moneyed interests. And so our friends in Congress are telling us that they are getting 10 times more calls against the deal than for the deal. Now, who is making these calls? Questionable, because we were in Oneonta in upstate New York the other day, and we were giving a talk, And a man raised his hand and he said, I just got a call telling me that I should contact my Senator Gillibrand against the deal, and that he would patch me into her office so I could say I was against the deal. And this guy said, but I'm not against the deal, I'm for the deal. And why are you against the deal? Why are you calling me? And the guy said, well, I'm getting paid to call you. And he said, well, how much are you being paid to do this? And the guy said, 75 cents an hour.
Prison.
And our friend said, 75 cents an hour? That doesn't make any sense. I would quit that job right away. And he said, I can't, I'm in prison. So we just heard this on Friday, and we're trying to check it out and get some journalists to check this out. Whatever the case is, the other side is using all kinds of tricks. And one of those tricks is that it takes our congresspeople to Israel on regular junkets paid for by AIPAC to see the Israeli government's view of the Israeli-Palestine situation, as well as the Iran situation. And you know, these are like obligatory trips for every freshman in Congress. If you say no to one of these trips, it's like you're an anti-Semite, you hate Israel, you know, you must be an awful person, we're gonna work against you. That's really kind of how it is. It's seen as obligatory that you take one of these AIPAC-sponsored trips, and every 2 years, the freshmen in Congress go on these trips. And right now, the recess, when you think of all the important issues that Congress should be back in their districts to be talking to their constituents about, instead, 58 members of them, every single freshman except for three of them, are on a trip to Israel. And they are getting an earful about how bad this Iran deal is. So we're up against a big opposition. Now, the idea that's floating out there is that Congress will vote down this deal, then Obama will veto it, and then we have to hold on to just one-third of the representatives in either the House or the Senate to be able to make sure that that veto doesn't get overrided. I mean, it's a low, 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 low bar that we have, but we have to make sure that happens. So let's talk when we open this up about what you all are doing and what more can be done. Because we can't let him just wait to the last minute. He has to come out soon, because these spineless members of Congress are waiting to see who comes out before they will come out. And when you have a safe state like Massachusetts, you need your senators to come out quickly. It's very interesting that only one Democratic senator has come out against the deal so far, and that is Chuck Schumer. Chuck Schumer, spoo. It is really disgusting. Come on, let's face it. It is really disgusting. I mean, first of all, it's his party, the Democratic Party. It's his president who designed this deal. It's something that is, you know, good for all of us. And he thinks it's more important to represent the right-wing government of Israel than it is to represent us in this country. It's absolutely disgusting. And he wants to be a leader in his party. Come on. So what is interesting, though, is that after Schumer came out, there was great fear among a number of us that that was going to then set the pace to allow other Democratic senators to come out and say, okay, I'm against it, I'm against it. And so far, not one other Democratic senator has come out to say no. So that's a good sign. But every day we should think that the clock is ticking. We only have, this all has to be finished by September 17th. They come back right after Labor Day. That's really only a 10-day window that they have to decide this. This is going to be the most important vote since the vote on the Iraq War. And during that time around the Iraq War, we were in a better position because we could get lots of people out on the streets. We could get hundreds of thousands of people out on the streets. We had a real movement. We don't have that movement anymore. most of the peace movement has gone on to work on other things. So it's really hard to get people out anymore. So Labor Day is going to come up on the 7th of September, and guess what? AIPAC is telling people to fly in from all over the country to be there to greet Congress when they return. We just found this out. Thank you very much. And now we have to use that information to encourage people who are for the deal to come to Washington, D.C. and be with us as Tighe Barry builds an encampment outside of Congress every single day to be a presence saying, vote in favor of this nuclear deal. So if anybody here can come, raise your hand if you could spend any time in Washington, D.C. between September 8th and September 17th. Can anybody do it? All right, we have a couple of people here who can do it. Let's give them a hand. Thank you very much. Do any of you need some funding to come and do it? Maybe we should pass the hat and let you use it for that. Why don't we pass the hat? Yeah, let's pass the hat and try to get more of you able to come to Washington, D.C. and spend some time with us. Tighe, you have a hat there. Very good, a pink hat.
Help someone come.
So help somebody from your area represent you and try to counter the AIPAC people who probably are being given money to fly there. Because the last time we met a bunch of AIPAC people, they were all given money, airplane tickets, and fancy hotels in order to get to Washington, D.C. So let me end by the last country in the axis of diplomacy that I wanted to talk about, and that is North Korea. North Korea is a country ruled by a very repressive dictatorship. But North Korea is also a continent that has suffered from the lack of a peace process since 1953. When there was a terrible war, the Korean War from 1950 to 1953, that left 4 million people on that peninsula dead, and that destroyed so much of the entire peninsula, including most of North Korea, absolutely obliterated during that war. And we went with 30 women to do what has only been done twice before since 1953, and that is get permission to cross the demilitarized zone, which is the most militarized zone actually in the world. And we got permission from the north, from the south, from the UN that controls the demilitarized zone, to get 30 women from around the world to come together to meet in North Korea, cross the demilitarized zone into South Korea, calling for finally in the Korean Peninsula to have a process of reconciliation. And it was a beautiful, beautiful action to be part of. It also blew away the stereotypes that I had of the North Korean women, because I thought they would all be robotics. Did anybody see that horrible movie, The Interview? The terrible movie that caused this big flap. Well, it just plays into the stereotypes around North Korea. And so many of us really had no idea how open the Korean women would be to talking with us. And we had wonderful exchanges with the Korean women. And in one of the exchanges, the older women were saying to us, because there has been no reconciliation process, we still hold the open wounds of the war that dates back to the 1950s. And we had a psychologist with us on our delegation. And she said, unless you have the processes like happened in South Africa with the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, or some kind of way for people to really move beyond the trauma, that those wounds stay generation after generation after generation. And it's true. The North Koreans hate the South Koreans, and the South Koreans hate the North Koreans on one level. On another level, they recognize that they are all the same people. And there have been families trying to meet their relatives in the North now and they're in their 80s, they're ready to die without ever being able to see their family members again. And in one of the meetings that we had with the women, the older women were telling us these horrendous stories. There was a woman who had no arms, and she told us how she was 7 years old. The soldiers came into her village, killing all the adults, put her on the floor, and chopped off her arms and left her like that. And when we were crying, she would come over to us with her sleeves and try to wipe away the tears from our eyes. And there was a 80-year-old woman who got up and started telling us about how they killed off her parents, and in the whole village, the adults were killed. And that they were only left the children to fend for themselves, to try to figure out how to find food, how to survive. And as she's telling us the stories, she's crying as she's remembering how difficult it was, how many of the young people just died from hunger. And when the session was over, we went over and we were all hugging and we were all kissing and we were all crying and apologizing for the role that our government played. And this one woman in her 80s picked me up and she started twirling me around and twirling me around and twirling me around and then put me down on the ground and started dancing with me. And I'm thinking, what is going on here? Getting dizzy. And she says, "You don't really know us. That we are a people that love to dance and we love to sing. And right now is a time of tears. But we want to make sure that you're going to come back here one day, and I hope I am still alive," she said. "When the North and South have been reconciled, when the North and the United States and the rest of the world have been reconciled, and instead of coming here to hear sad stories, we can come to sing and to dance together." And I thought, what a beautiful way to frame the whole issue. And I want to end on that note, which is to say that so many people around the world are aching to end the wars, are aching for reconciliation. And we have to do more to play our part as Americans to move towards a policy where we are treating the world with compassion, with love, with kindness, that we are using our best minds, the people in our State Department, to come up with non-violent political solutions to the policies, to the conflicts around the world, and we can finally say that we're going to put an end to war, and we're going to dance and sing and love with our neighbors around the world. Thank you. So, other suggestions, ideas, questions, disagreements?
I just wonder how many people here have written to Markey about this issue of
How many people have written to Markey about this issue?
Deal.
About this.
And what did you get? I got, "Thank you for sending me a letter."
So she got a response saying, "Thank you for sending me a letter," and that was it.
That's it.
Anybody else get a different response from...
Well, I called up a week ago and was told that Ed hadn't decided yet, and I just asked, what can possibly be the consideration that makes him not want to support? And the aide said, "Well, I don't know." And I said, "Well, I would like you to ask him and call me back, because I need to know, because I can't imagine why he wouldn't support this if he still haven't called me back." So I'm going to follow up again.
And what did you get, Pucky?
I got the same thing.
Yeah, and you?
I had a long conversation with whoever answered the phone in his office and asked the same thing, what's holding him up. And he said, "Well, he's trying to learn both sides of the issue, and when I went on the website and looked, his foreign policy advisor is a retired military guy. And when I tried to find out information about him, I had to become a member of LinkedIn in order to find out his bigger biography, which I haven't done."
Uh-huh. Yes?
Hi, Ed's wife is a psychiatrist. He discusses everything with his wife a lot. And I don't know who she is, but she's a psychiatrist with a lot of influence in Boston, in he's moved a lot of his positions over the years because I think they're a table conversation.
Yes.
Yes, I'm curious about, you've touched on a lot of issues, and I'm curious about what thoughts you have on the role of multinational corporations, sort of outside the, you focused a lot on the conduct of governments, and you've certainly touched, intimated about the impact of money on politics, which we know about. But I'm wondering if you have more to say or any perspective you'd like to share on the influence of, let's say, international elites, both in, from this country but throughout the world.
So the question is, what about the influence of corporations? And I would say, just as there is the influence of big oil that keeps us from moving into a green economy that we need to continue to survive in this world, so we have the influence of the military-industrial complex that keeps us in these wars. There are a small number of companies that get very, very wealthy from continuing the conflicts. You see in Washington, D.C., constantly the ads taken out in the Washington Post by Boeing and by Northrop Grumman, and say, you know, we say happy day to the American people, or, you know, whatever the holiday is. And I think, oh, God, you know, that's our tax money that just goes, flows to these big weapons manufacturers. There's also the contractors, and you know, so much of our military has been privatized, just like the prisons in this country privatized, that there is a momentum for wars to keep going. It's like this drone technology. It's a lot of money. And just about every major weapons manufacturer, and I have a chapter on the book just on who's doing the producing, they get into the act. We even see Bernie Sanders, unfortunately, with the F-35s, encouraging them to be based in the National Guard in Vermont, because it's jobs for Vermont. And so when you get somebody like Bernie Sanders even talking about jobs in the military, I mean, these military manufacturers are so smart that they have some piece of some weapon system produced in every single district, congressional district, in the United States. And so it becomes this absurd thing about jobs. So yes, the power of corporations is felt in every area that we work in, and particularly around this. We have General Eisenhower back in the 1950s, before he was even president, warning us about the undue influence of the military-industrial complex. And now you have to add in there the congressional complex, the security complex, the universities, and how much they are connected. You talk to engineering students today, and they'll tell you that in the quote best engineering schools in the United States, they're getting a lot of money from DARPA, from the Pentagon's research arm, or filtered through DARPA in some way. So I would say the influence is everywhere. And it's hard for us sometimes to decide whether we focus on trying to change government policy or we try to change corporate policy. In some areas, it's easier to change corporate policy when they have particularly a retail arm where you could do some kind of boycott activity, where you could actually reach them and sully their brand name. But that's very hard to do with weapons manufacturers.
Totally right that they're all tied up together, because the change in the state of Massachusetts from the MCAPs to the Common Core is all about what they call college to career. And a lot of that money, it's all corporate money. And there are people like Warren Buffett and the Microsoft guy. They want to channel the direction of education toward corporate employment for young people.
Sure. And of course, let's look at just the obscene level of debt that students are saddled with when they go out of university. And think of how many countries around the world where college is free. In fact, there are many places in the world where it's not only free, you're given a stipend so that you can actually live and eat and have a roof over your head while you go to college and come out with absolutely no debt at all. And here it's seen as, you know, so extreme to be calling for free college education.
So I'm with Mothers Out Front, and I have an email blast that's going out to Ed Markey tomorrow.
Oh, great.
So it's about the $7 billion subsidies per year that go to fossil fuel companies, asking where he stands on that and what he's going to do about getting rid of that. So I want to thank you for letting us know that he's not yet supporting this nuclear deal, so I can add that to
fabulous. Excellent. Very good. Yes. I mean, before we drop this issue of Markey, I would just like to focus on it a little bit more and get some more enthusiasm from you all to do something about it. We were in New York State and people got really enthusiastic because it's Chuck Schumer and he already said no, and so they're going to do sit-ins in his offices all over the state. But I think there's a lot more that you could do around Markey, and that your actions could actually push to get him to come out in favor of the deal very quickly, which will really have an impact on others.
Could you repeat what she just said, because I'm not sure, I could barely hear.
Well, she has an email blast going out to Mothers Up Front that focuses on the oil issues.
Did others get involved in that, or?
Well, it's an online action.
Okay.
But sign up.
Yes.
Sign
up. Can we just organize several groups to go and physically talk to Ed Markey? I know he has an office in Springfield. I don't know when he's there.
Markey in Springfield.
August 26th.
And certainly talking to his staff, whether it's to him. There's a National Day of Action on August 26th. It would be great to organize something at that time, if that worked for you. Yes?
I just sent an email.
Louder.
Could you speak a little louder?
No, I said I just sent an email to his chief aide. I generally meet in their office in Washington once a month. And I'm sure he'd be interested about this meeting and conversations we had earlier at the picnic about this issue. So I want to make a point at the end of the talk.
Is your name?
Well,
yes,
so what a sum up is that that you go to Washington once a month to have a meeting there, and that you've met with his chief of staff on, and will continue to do so on this issue. But I think since we have a large group here right now, it would be good if somebody would agree to try to set up a meeting in Springfield, or to whatever you would like to do.
AFC is participating in the August 26th action.
And what are you planning for around here?
I guess that would be people are willing to go all the way down, but we'll go to the office.
So we've got the organizer right here, Jeff, to organize a group to go to Springfield and do something outside his office. So hands up, you'll make a call tomorrow, all of you, and put it out on your Facebook and other places. Tell other people to make a call. I can't tell you enough how shameful it is that Markey has not come out already. It really is shameful. I mean, if I lived in the state, I would be protesting. I wouldn't be nicely saying, can you please sign this? I'd be saying, why the hell haven't you signed this yet? So get a little, you know, get a little more angry. Urgent. Yes.
I sent a donation to Move On today because thanks to our old friend Joe Lieberman, there is a big billboard in Washington that says, thank you,
Chuck
Schumer.
Right.
And so Move On is planning another billboard to respond to that billboard. And I'm thinking that something like the billboard war might be more noticeable and more creative and interesting if we could come up with a billboard to respond to the Thank You Schumer billboard.
We are actually making a billboard.
And we could have a
right
Thank
now.
You Elizabeth Warren billboard. Or
did everybody hear? Yes? You all heard?
No, we didn't.
Oh, so that there, that some folks have put up a bill. You heard her?
Yeah, didn't
yes.
hear time.
Oh, okay. So, you know, that's great, and billboards cost money, and it's good to donate, but we do have folks that are planning free billboards, which means banner hangs.
And, no, about 30 minutes.
And so you might want to do your own banner hang or banner freeway bannering or however you do them around here. But say, I would say to Ed Markey, why haven't you signed on to the deal yet or something like that? But yes, great idea to do something visual to embarrass him.
Thanks, Elizabeth. Where's Ed?
Thanks, Elizabeth. Where's Ed? Iran deal now. All right, some other issues, questions, topics, ideas, organizing, anything you would like to do before we wrap up? Yes.
I'd like to thank you actually for speaking up about the Black Lives Matter movement. It's an issue that I've actually been working on myself. I'm going to be in a graphic novel coming out really soon where we talk about allyship in it, and I just want to thank you for being a good ally.
Well, there are other people here. Billy, you look like you might be ready to leave. What, can I ask you a question since you've done so much to support Black Lives Matter? Maybe just say a little of what you've done and what other people might do?
I know there are people organizing here. I just moved here. Raise your hands if you're organizing on Black Lives Matter.
You and other people?
Not too many.
So maybe folks can get together with these folks after and get involved in local organizing.
And do you have any suggestions?
I just moved here.
The local group.
He is an amazing organizer, this guy, so watch out.
The local group is called Black Lives Matter 413, which is our area
code. Black Lives Matter 413, yes.
There's also a group that's just getting started called Western Mass Showing Up for Racial Justice. That's
Western Mass Showing Up for Regional Justice.
No, Racial Justice.
Racial Justice.
And it's specifically for white allies who are wanting to work in white communities against racism.
So Deborah, we're here for white allies working in white communities against racism.
On Facebook, it's Western Mass, S-U-R-J.
Yes. Western Mass, S-U-R-J.
Surge for racial justice.
Surge.
Yes. Yes.
Do you know where Bernie Sanders stands on this issue of the deal with Iran?
He is in favor of the deal with Iran. One thing that we're just not all that happy about is that he's not talking about it very much. And he really hasn't been talking about foreign policy very much at all. You know, as a senator, he has said wonderful things about the bloated military budget, the need to cut that budget, and he barely brings it up at all now. And so, you know, there are those of us who are pushing him and his campaign to just be more vocal in support of the Iran deal, to be pushing the other senators to support it, and to speak more about how we can use a lot of that money that's going to the military to a lot better uses here at home.
Let me just say this.
Yeah.
Yesterday we heard great things from people in New York State who are going on the 26th to different of Schumer's offices, and that if we in Western Mass talk with our friends in the Boston area about coordinating with them and having people from the peace community who want Markey to sign on right away, that I think the same thing could happen here, that letting people know across the Commonwealth that the people who have people of conscience want that vote and want him to stand on diplomacy. So if you know people in Boston, and let's throw this out to Jeff, our good AFSC person, because you have AFSC people on both ends of the Commonwealth, to find out what they're doing, to encourage them to join us, and to help provide a link so that we know they're going, they know we're going, and maybe we can get some
really
press about that.
Yeah.
And Medea, could you give a little bit more about the timeline? Could you talk about the timeline? Why the 26th? What's happening after Labor Day? These kind of dates, so people.
So August 26th is a National Day of Action. We're this under the Bush years, you know, we could get lots of people out. We can't get lots of people out anymore, which is a terrible shame. But we can get people to be doing things online. We can get them to be calling. So National Day of Action, do something on the 26th. Whether or not you can go to one of the offices, at least use that day to make calls. If you look online on the Code Pink website, codepink.org/Iran, we have a list of 97 undecided members of Congress. You can call every single undecided senators and they will not ask you if you are in their state. It doesn't matter. Call them. When it gets to the people, the members of the House, They might ask you for a zip code, and we have been saying this is a national issue, and so we are calling you, and they say, fine, thank you for calling, and they put us in the tally. So you can make a personal commitment to call every one of those congresspeople, and it will be a very important thing to do. We can't offer you 75 cents an hour, I'm very sorry. This is really, really important, and we are not up to the task in terms of where our movement is right now. I have to just admit that. We're at the level where we are just screaming Bloody Mary to anybody who hasn't come out in favor of this, locking ourselves by our arms to their office desks and not leaving until they say they're in favor. We should be doing so much more, but we don't have the movement right now. So we need whatever you're willing to do it and then do a little more.
But what about the Labor Day and the vote?
So the Labor Day, they come back right after Labor Day. There's going to be a vote right after that during that week. That will probably be when they vote down the deal. And we should be having an uproar and calling everybody who voted against the deal and saying, why did you do that? Because there's going to be another vote. And that's going to be after the presidential veto. So be ready for these occasions. Don't be caught by surprise when Congress votes this down. Write them now. Say, how could Congress go against this deal and send it out immediately when they vote this down? So that happens right after Labor Day. And then it all has to be done between now and September 17th, a very, very, very short window. And imagine how you would feel if you hadn't made those calls, if you hadn't done anything in Congress to override the presidential veto. And we were alone in the community of nations, except for the U.S. We're going to go ahead with this deal. And then we're going to have these Republicans who are vying with each other to see who is going to be more militaristic, who is going to be more, I hate Iran, Iran, the people are horrible, it's the source of all evil, there are no moderates in Iran. Because if you watch those Republican debates, they were trying to outdo each other. One saying, Scott Walker, I'm going to rip that deal up on day one if you elect me president. And Carly Fiorina, you get the nice feminine voice who's running for office. She's saying, God damn it, I'm going to call to my good buddy Netanyahu first and say, we're with you all the way. And then I'm going to give an earful to these Ayatollahs and tell them to, you know, they better get in line or we're going to go in there and wipe them out. And then you get Huckabee saying, well, I'm not going to only wipe out their nuclear facilities. We should go in there militarily and change the government. Just change that government. So it will be horrible if this deal is voted down, because that is the path to war, and we can't allow ourselves to go down that path.
Can I point out one thing? I made this banner in 2007. I made this under the Bush regime. This banner I made in Bush regime time. So we were talking about this in 2006 and 2007, trying to get diplomacy with Iran. We finally have it.
Yeah, let's not let it slip through our fingers.
I want to just say with great humility that I wasn't really going to come to this event. I had a friend visiting from New York who has met you. And one of the reasons that I've been a long time activist, progressive activist in New York. And, you know, my admission is that I don't know really what the deal is. I don't know, I mean, if I were to, I really liked Francis Crowe's comment about the effectiveness of letters to the editor sometimes, but I have no talking points. I don't have really even, honestly, the most fundamental information about, I mean, I'm very persuaded about, you know, with your analysis and all that sort, but there's a lot of talk about the deal, and so I don't know what the deal is, mm-hmm. I can't imagine being effective in any way and communicating with anyone without a little more meat on those bones or tofu on those bones.
Yes.
So.
Yes. Well, thank you for bringing that up. And If you go to our website, codepink.org/Iran, we will have the talking points on there. There's flyers that you can download if you're going into any office and want to hand something out. There's a script for what you can say when you call. There are links to very good articles that have been written. There's a lot of good information. There's infographics that many groups have put out. There's a very, very good coalition of groups that have been working together that have distilled this into good talking points. You're not supposed to be an expert on nuclear issues. You're supposed to be somebody as a constituent who actually has read something about this, but does recognize that if our government spent all this time, not just the US, but along with China, Russia, the UK, France, and Germany, coming up with an agreement that all of those countries agreed to and the entire United Nations agreed to, that should be enough for you to say, if the UN Security Council thought this was a good deal, and it is a way to keep us on a non-militaristic path, that's something that I support. The other thing to recognize, without going into details about the deal itself, is that when President Obama said that the Republicans are playing into the hands of the conservatives in Iran, that is true. The conservatives in Iran don't want this deal. This deal is actually strong. And when Lindsey Graham says, there ain't no moderates in Iran, they're all a bunch, I mean, it's just not true. The government is a moderate government. The government of Rouhani is a moderate government. And the people of Iran got rid of the Ahmadinejad government and voted for Rouhani because they wanted a different government, just like we went from Bush to Obama. And that has to be recognized, and that has to be applauded. And this deal came through because a moderate government came into power that wanted the deal because they wanted to be closer to the West. They want to lift the sanctions. They want to improve the daily lives of their own people. And lifting the sanctions is not the way it's portrayed in the United States, that this is going to give Iran money to then go spread extremism in the world. Lifting the sanctions is going to mean that they're going to be closer to the West and that we will have more influence. It's just like the Cuba issue, more direct contact, more direct influence. And I just want to bring up one other area that we didn't talk about now that you bring this up, because there's so much fear-mongering about Iran and how awful they are and how the source of all evil. And I've traveled a lot to the Middle East, just as Tig has traveled a lot to the Middle East, Paki has traveled a lot to the Middle East. I don't know, I'm sure others of you here. One, Iran is one of the most U.S.-friendly country I've ever been to. They love Americans in Iran. The people of Iran treat you like honored guests when they hear you are from the United States. And the other thing is that there is a country, an Arab country, in the Middle East that spreads a lot of extremism, and that is Saudi Arabia. And Saudi Arabia is the good ally, in addition to Israel, of the United States. And that is just appalling when you look at what Saudi Arabia is like. When you look at the way women are repressed in Saudi Arabia, they can't do anything without a male guardian, they can't drive, they can't marry without the permission of a male, they can't vote. When you see how they crack down on their own internal human rights activists in Saudi Arabia, there's a case of a blogger, Raif Badawi, that we have been supporting, who got sentenced to 10 years in jail and 1,000 lashes to be given out in increments of 50 lashes every Friday after prayer in a public place. I mean, absolutely medieval kind of stuff, disgusting. 15 of the 19 hijackers from Saudi Arabia, Osama bin Laden from Saudi Arabia, and Saudi Arabia putting a lot of money into spreading Wahhabism, the extreme form of Islam, all over the Middle East and Northern Africa. And if you want to talk about one country other than Israel that has invaded so many of its neighbors, neighbors, that is not Iran, that is Saudi Arabia. And Saudi Arabia has gone in to crush the democratic uprising in Bahrain, where some of us went to support wonderful, fabulous human rights activists that are in prison. And Saudi Arabia is now bombing people every single day in Yemen that has caused a humanitarian crisis of huge proportions. So, you know, we have a government that is seen around the world as the height of hypocrisy, whether it's our nuclear weapons and saying you can't, or whether it's we hate Iran and we love Saudi Arabia and we love Israel, you know, it doesn't make a lot of sense for the rest of the people in the world. So I think, yes, it's important to learn more about this nuclear deal, but it's also important to understand that this is a lot about politics and not about what's really going to keep us safe. And if we wanted to talk about something that would keep us safe, we would say scrap the $60 billion weapon sales, the largest weapon sales in the history of humankind that we have with Saudi Arabia. That would do more to keep us safe than a lot of what the United States is doing right now.
What do you know about support for the Iran deal within Israel?
So support for the Iran deal within Israel, I mean, you see polls that say different things, but one of the very interesting things is that many of the generals in the military in Israel have come out in support of the deal. And J Street is taking their testimonies and trying to get them in front of Congress, trying to get some of them here to talk, because they know that a war with Iran would be absolutely devastating. They know how Iran could retaliate that would spread throughout the Middle East. So the people most in the know about what it really means to move down this path tend to be the people who are against it. Now, the same way that we have heard a lot of propaganda in the United States that turns people against the deal, many Israelis have been hearing for years and years how Iran is a threat to, an existential threat to Israel, and so that does color people's perceptions. Any final thoughts? I see we have gone on quite a long time. Let's hear, we'll take these last two.
I just would like to share a resource. If anybody wants to join the Black Lives, movement text loop, all you have to do is text the @ symbol BLM413 to 23559.
Well, maybe we could write that out and put it on the table over there if anybody wants to do that. That sounds great. And we have one other comment here.
I made a sheet of paper today that has
Can you speak louder?
Some quotes of Elizabeth Warren.
About the Iran deal. So just to remind you that you probably put your hand up to call Markey's office tomorrow. I actually have some confidence that I think Markey will support the Iran deal. He has made himself the point person about nuclear proliferation. And the piece that I think in general thinks his statements about that have not been strong enough, but I really think that he will not turn against his own previous statements.
And against the president.
We should be happy that the other senator from New York, President Gillibrand, has come out for the deal. And the other, not only Sanders in Vermont, but Leahy in Vermont. So I've been making phone calls to congressional offices in so far just in New England, and I really think things are turning. The Massachusetts delegation is almost all for their one.
But the point is that Markey should have come out already. And, you know, each day that he delays gives other people in Congress reason to say, well, I'm not going to come out for it. I'm going to wait till all those progressive Democrats come out for it first.
If he does, I think it will make it.
Well, let's make it tomorrow.
Yes, let's make him. And also let's recognize that in some states, they're making deals among themselves. You vote against it and I'll vote for it. And that's what they did in New York. And let's not let that happen here in Massachusetts.
The other thing about diplomacy is that diplomacy can spread. And that's what's so wonderful about this agreement, is that if you stabilize the Middle East in this way, you might have some diplomacy about Syria. And, you know, we'll have to hold our noses, but part of it will be perhaps the Saudis and the United States and the Chinese and so forth that have affected this Iran deal might actually work together.
Right.
And it may possibly be because they have had to work together for 4 years to get this deal. So there's a lot of irony.
That's right, and it is beautiful to think of what could come out of this in terms of the region working together, the old enemies of Saudi Arabia and Iran working together to try to find solutions to what's happening in Syria as well as what's happening in Yemen. So there's a lot of possibilities that could come out of it if the deal goes through. And lastly, somebody had asked me when I came in about some of the trips with Code Pink, so I just want to mention that before we close. We have been taking trips to Cuba to celebrate the new opening. The next one will be in December, and part of that trip, in addition to going to Havana and the other end of the island, Santiago, we will be spending 3 days in Guantanamo to look at the issue of U.S. bases there. And then we have another trip in February and another one in May. If you're interested in those, we're also taking a delegation to Palestine during the olive harvest this year. That's in November. And the final trip we're doing is one of the very long-standing conflicts that has not been resolved, and that is Western Sahara, which will be very, very interesting. So if you're interested in traveling anywhere around the world with us, and we do go places, a lot of places domestically, like Washington, D.C., where we hope you'll come. And right now, as we speak, the co-founder of Code Pink, Jody Evans, flew to Houston and then going an hour outside of Houston to join the sit-in outside the jail where Sandra Bland appeared dead. And for those of you who don't know that story, it's the young woman who was pulled out of her vehicle in such a violent way, taken off to prison, and then appeared dead. And so there is a call that we put out to all of our people in Texas to go join that vigil, and Jody joined it today. So
I just have to say, traveling with Code Pink is first class. maybe not first class, you know, five-star room hotels.
No,
but
definitely
first class intelligence. Code Pink, especially Medea, is considered a rock star in Cuba. You get interviews and you get spoken to as though you have a brain, and it is just really top-notch. If you can do it, do it.
Yeah.
Wonderful.
And one last thing. We have some of these drone warfare killing by remote control made written by my favorite author, and she's willing to sign over here if anybody wants to.
So thank you so much for coming out. Thanks for all you're doing, and I'm very excited about upping the ante and pushing and marking more on this.